God who will do it again.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Cindy. Thank you. Praise God, he'll do it again. Praise his holy name. Thank you for being here today. Wow, the times we are living in, what songs during worship, they met us just right where we should be today. And that song that Cindy just sang, all of them just meet us where we are today. And we give God all the glory and praise. And before we jump into the message, we want also to just be so thankful for the great meeting that the guys had, the men had. And Brother Marvin said they had a great, great time and had a great crowd. So praise God for that. Amen. Come on, church. Give them a hand. Wonderful. And it's good to see a lot of folks here who have not been able to be around because of sickness or whatever. We're just glad you're here. Amen.
Amen.
And we pray and we hope you're glad you're here. Hallelujah. After today, thank you, Jesus. Sometimes I have to kind of throw that in, you know. Hallelujah. So, let me catch you up on a few things before we jump right into the message. Again, reminding people that's just part of my calling, you know, to keep us abreast of where we are and what's going on. God does not want us ignorant. So we need to know and understand things. If I could put a title, this is not the title of my message, so don't y'all get it confused in the tape room over there, okay? If I could put of the things I'm going to share with you right now before the message, I'd probably say danger up ahead. And, say flashing lights, you know, and pay attention. So many of you probably already know what I will be sharing with you. But again, it's my responsibility to make sure that you are aware of a lot of things. Again, I'm aware that very few churches are taking the time to share. Everybody doesn't have the same calling. And so all I have to do is be faithful to my calling. So that's why I try to tell you. I will say what I always say. Whatever I present to you, I guarantee you is factual. And I'll assure you if at any point what I share that, you know, I always, even this morning early, I was saying, Lord, is this what you want me to say? Is this correct? We all are capable of missing God.
That's right.
And if I miss him at any point, how many of you know I've come back and said, let me correct that?
That's right. Yeah.
And I will if anything is said. But I said this before, early this morning as I was talking with him. So let me put it the way that I have notes everywhere. I hope I can read them. Putin, as most of you know, who of course is like the president, prime minister, whatever you want to call him, of Russia, has issued a stern warning to the United States and to its European allies, I'm reading directly this morning, that if Ukraine uses long-range missiles to reach the interior of Russia, he will consider it an act of war by NATO countries. Putin stated that the Ukraine does not possess the capability to launch any high precision weapons on its own and would rely on the United States or Europe to provide the intelligence to execute any such strikes. It will take intelligence from satellites, and Ukraine does not have such. Putin says that if the United States or Europe allows such to happen, it is an act of war, World War III. And he will do something tactical in response. Now, let me help you understand, they've been using our weapons already. But there comes a red line, and there comes a time, and we're talking about, missiles that can go far-reaching into Russia that we have supplied. They have them. We've supplied them. Britain has supplied them. They have. It's not a matter of will we do it. We have done it. And, and Tony Blinken, who, of course, is a spokesman for the Biden, for our administration, stated that they are giving the Ukraine the okay to attack Russia, as well as Great Britain has said the same. And remember, they'd be interested probably in the oil fields and the refineries in the capital and such. And the chief of the military of NATO's, the chief of, I've got my little things, hang on, chief of military for the NATO committee stated that he believes it is militarily justified for the Ukraine to use long-range missiles weapons to strike the targets in Russia. So that's NATO giving the approval. We are a part of that, but that's him taking that stand and doing that. That happened yesterday. And so the question is, will Russia attack us? And will they do it before the election? It depends on what happens in the next days, what the Ukraine actually does. They're not waiting on our weapons to get to them. They know what Putin has said. So it's a matter of waiting to see what happened. Of course, another interesting thing that the Lord spoke about 2 months ago, I don't think I said much about it, but when he first said it, I thought, oh, no, I don't want it. Let's be here. And when he said there's going to be an October surprise or an October event, when that was first stated, about 2 months ago, when he first said that to me, my answer again was, oh, no, we need to be out of here, you know, in case he didn't know it. I'm trying to help him, you know. And so interesting, since that time, everywhere it's being stated that something may happen now in October, between now and October, to be absolutely honest. And even a date has been put out for whatever it's worth. I have no idea what it means. But October the 9th, I don't know what that means. But the question again is, we do know if Russia decides to attack us based on, again, what the Ukraine does. And we also know that they want to keep pursuing. So I don't know what Zelensky will do. I have no idea. But we do know if Russia decides to do something, when Putin does things or says he's going to do something, he does it. He's not one who plays around saying what he might and might not do. He also, if you have paid attention to him and his activities over the last couple of years, you also know that he has been paying attention to us. And so if he's going to do something, I'll assure you it will be probably before the election. He has stated bluntly why he would do something or make any move, because he sees us at this point in time extremely weak. Now, I'm just quoting him. And let me also remind you, as crazy as it seems, and whatever it means, is that Congress is shutting down for October. Now, they use the reason they do it so they can get out in politic during that month. But I just would keep all kind of things in my mind. You know, you already know that there are nuclear subs of Russia around Miami and around the East Coast, all the way up, especially around Washington and New York and West Coast. You know, they're around Alaska and Washington State and Oregon. They've been there. They are now the nuclear subs from Russia. I'm talking about Russia now, that are there. So there are concerns everywhere. If something happens, will the election be put on pause? I don't know. There is a clause in our Constitution that says if there's a crisis, that can happen. Other things is that the United Nations now, they have that formal meeting, the signed documents, is on September 22 through 24. The main dates of signing things are 22 and 23, close out on the 24th. But the United Nations right now is pushing with everything they have for a two-state solution. We know that. They have allowed a seat in the United Nations for the Palestinians, and they're not even a country. But the United Nations has done that. That was done a while back. There are many things that are happening, and one of them this morning, and I'll come back to these, but in Israel this morning, the Houthis from Yemen launched a ballistic missile, and it ended up in the middle of the country, very close to Jerusalem. Now, it took Israel by surprise. No one was expecting something to come from Yemen to hit them. And it's a very, very serious issue. And this morning, as I was writing all of this, this morning, the war committee and everybody else in Israel was meeting. There will be a response. Because, as I say, everyone's shocked. You have to look at your little map where Yemen is to see that something could reach all the way to the very middle of Israel. There is a big betrayal probably coming to Israel, and it may happen actually before the election. And we need to be aware of this. We need to be praying. I mean, it's very, very difficult in America now, in the total America population. 60% of the folks are against Israel. And it is growing daily. Ignorance is a terrible thing. When you do not know your history, when you do not know the Bible, then it is terrible, and it's very easy to just people join a mob and to become a part of something. And if you were to ask them why they're doing this, why are you voting that way, why are you doing this, why are you marching, I don't know, just, you know, it's, I don't even know what it's about, but let's go for it. I hate to say that that is so, but that is the truth. Now, the other thing is that there are internal wars in the United States. There are groups that have come in from other nations and to try to stir up racial wars, go back and dig up things that we had hoped would have been buried. Racial wars, gender wars, ethnic groups, whatever you want to call it. And at this moment, 36 states with schools, are being threatened with shootings, mass shootings, targeting young people. And that young girls are being kidnapped in America and being paid millions of dollars by American to capture Americans. And we're talking about like 12 through 18 year olds, not talking about the youngest of the youngest. Church, we must stand together. Interesting enough, the United Nations just let out a report that when they install their new person, their director, whomever, which was in this meeting of the 22nd through the 24th, when they install this new person, they've always had them in a four-year term. But for no reason that they explained, they now are saying they want that person to be there for 7 years. Just interesting things that if you were to come on Monday and Thursday, we could tell you more about. But hallelujah. Many things. One of the things, before we go into this message, one of the things that bothers me the most and just shakes me up so bad is knowing that foreign nations are infiltrating our nation, wanting greatly for there to be great disturbances, wanting the election process to be canceled or whatever, and to stir it up so that there will be a crisis as to why that would not take place. We have enemies everywhere, and of course we'd let millions into the country. But we have enemies, and the ones coming in did not just wander in. Many were sent for the sole purpose of where they are gathering in the middle of this country, just waiting to attack and to do this country in. But I said, Lord, hold the church tight. We must stand together. It just hit me so hard. I thought we have fought 40-something years to show that we can stand together, love each other, really be faithful. Don't let racial stuff tear us apart. Please, God, of all the teachings and all of the revelations that this church has, please let us, oh God, plant us in your word that we are a new nation in ourselves, within you, that you have pulled us out of our old yesterdays, and you see us as an entirely new nation created by you. With neither racial issues, gender issues, or anything. We're just a new people. It's going to be tested. Not down the road. It's happening now. The 2024 message said, you must stand firmly. You're going to be required to stand. Everything about who we are is going to be shaken. And it could be starting today. It is not way off yonder at all. Jesus himself can come momentarily. There's nothing left to be fulfilled in order for him to come. We're now watching Revelation. We're watching the book come forth, particularly as we watch Israel. We're watching things that theologically and that we have not understood or misunderstood, put it in wrong time zones and wrong time places. And we, most people think, I hope it's not you, that we have a lot of time in front of us. We do not have a lot of time in front of us. And I can be showing you that biblically and pointing that out to you. It's just astounding to me. But to see what's happening, I just pray and I ask you, church, the devil sends in what I call moles, people to stir us, people to drop something in your ear, people to try to make you turn this way or that way and make you pull against what 41 years of us working together and loving and standing together has meant. We all have families, but to be absolutely honest, you are my family. Amen. Sincerely, from the depths of my being, you are my family. Just as these two that just went home, Rosemary and Nell, I know that I know, and I said, well, Lord, there goes two that I know prayed for me every day of their lives. They told me, please put somebody in their place. Please let somebody rise up and be faithful to that. Please, as they pray for this church. See, there's nothing more that this city or anybody around who wants to stir anything. This is the kind of church they want to split. because we are representing true Christianity.
Amen.
And so all I can say is, oh God, when you said be tight with each other, hold on to each other, stand, it's time, church.
Amen.
And I'm asking you to do it. You will never do it unless you understand what I'm going to preach to you this morning. You won't be able to do it. So as we go to the Word, the message today is, does truth matter? If you've ever been called upon to give evidence in a trial where you were required to speak the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help me God. Those words were then entered into a court record as a sworn testimony from you. And if you were later found to have lied under oath, you would likely be charged with the crime of perjury. Listen to me, church. Truth matters.
Yes.
Telling the truth matters.
Yes.
There are people that carry big Bibles and have big titles and have big ministries and whatever else. They have the missing element of truth about what they're doing and what they're saying. Let us not be found there. If it didn't matter, truth didn't matter. If it was left to just the whims or impulses of people, then everybody would be moved by emotions and free to lie about anything and everything. If there's no truth, then nothing is accurate, nothing is real, and nothing is trustworthy. When Jesus stood before Pilate, if you remember, upon Pilate, the Roman governor, as he was questioning just before he turned him over to be crucified, Pilate made this statement. He said, "So you're a king." And Jesus responded, "You say that I'm a king. Actually, I was born and came into this world to testify to the truth. All who love the truth recognize what I say is true."
Yeah.
Then Pilate said, "What is truth?" You read the scriptures and you'll find that he said that and turned and walked away from Jesus. Didn't give Jesus time to answer. It's unfortunate. It's in the book of John. It's unfortunate that Pilate walked away after asking the question, because his entire life could have been changed if he'd waited simply for an answer to that question. What is truth? For you see, church, truth will always be truth, regardless of disbelief or regardless of ignorance or regardless of lack of understanding. Truth is truth. Truth gives value to the words you speak, but we live in an age where truth is under attack. It's unbelievable how truth is being attacked, and most people do not or will not, are afraid or whatever, to do some fact checking. Truth is under attack where it is being redefined into something that the Bible does not even recognize.
That's right.
We're now told to live your truth, but there's no such thing as your truth or his truth or her truth or, you know, my truth. For the disciples of the Lord Jesus, there is one sure truth, and his name is Jesus.
Amen.
He not only speaks truth, he is the truth, and he declared it in John 14 when he said, "I am the way, I am the truth, and you know it, and I am the life."
Amen.
That's who I am, he says. Essence, how do we take that? There is no life outside of me. There is no truth outside of me, and you cannot get to heaven outside of me.
Amen.
The virtue of truth has mattered from the very beginning of time. Genesis 3:1, The serpent was the shrewdest of all the wild animals the Lord God had made. One day he asked the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat the fruit from any of the trees in the garden?" Now, did you ever stop to think that the first recorded question in the Bible had to do with truth? The serpent said really to Eve, "Did God really say that?" In other words, did God tell you the truth? Satan didn't ask that question because he didn't know the answer. He asked it to sow doubt in Eve's mind, to lead her into confusion so she would believe a lie. See, if you're not founded, if you don't know the word and you're not founded on it, you can be rattled real easy. And his agenda, it has never changed. Same identical agenda today he's using. We watched it this past week. If you sow doubt in Eve's mind, he said, he wanted to lead her into confusion so she would believe a lie. And his agenda has not changed. I just wanted to repeat it. On one occasion, when the Pharisees tried to justify their hypocrisy, Jesus replied in John 8, "For you are the children of your father, the devil." This is Jesus talking, by the way. It's in red print. "For you are the children of your father, the devil, and you love to do the evil things you do." Now, please remember, these are to the religious people. I mean, this is the teachers and the preachers and the evangelists of what we would call them today, and the ministers. And he says to them, they were the leaders. And he says, you're the children of your father, the devil. And you love to do the evil things he does. He was a murderer from the beginning. He's always hated the truth because there's no truth in him. When he lies, it's consistent with his character. For he's a liar and he's the father of lies. Those are pretty strong words from sweet Jesus. But around the world, there are churches who have succumbed to an emotionally based and people-pleasing kind of preaching. And truth has been sacrificed on the altar of respectability. As far back as 1966, when Time magazine published its controversial article, "God is Dead," a seed of falsehood was sown into this nation and the world, a seed that has grown absolutely unchecked and has now produced an entire culture that chases after self-determination, self-exaltation, and self-satisfaction. That in turn has developed the kind of irrational messages that we hear today. Things like turning little girls surgically into little boys and vice versa. Yes. Defining abortion as women's rights. My God, where's the child's rights? Amen. That statement is an abomination to God. Women's rights when it comes to abortion. He's the one who sent that spirit. And it's not just a little mass of skin. It's the beginning of what he caused to come on earth with destiny wrapped up in it. And to call it women's rights, killing a baby. As you can tell, I could get on a soapbox on this one. It is the most absurd thing that I've ever heard of, and Satan is the father of lies who has propagated this thing. Or justifying assisted suicide, as it's now just legal. It's now not just legal, but encouraged in Canada, and what's there will make its way. The culture war is raging, church. Darkness is intensifying, whether you're aware of it or not, and whether you understand it or not, it's there. At the heart of every perverse behavior prevalent in our society is a lack of truth. Man without God begins to embrace darkness and more darkness. Every perversity of society is an attack on truth. God doesn't care. It doesn't matter. It has nothing to do with God. This is not, help me. That is precisely why Jesus declared that some people love darkness more than they do light. But when they do, they risk their eternal future. And many don't even believe anymore that hell is a real place. And many denominations, many, I'm talking about major, that many of you came from. And it's rattling around in the one I came from, that hell does not exist. If ever there were a lie, that's one. The truth is, my friend, not believing in hell doesn't do away with hell. And refusing to believe it is indulging in not just a lie, but the assurance of a horrible experience that will last forever for you. Today's culture war isn't between political parties. Listen to me, church. It's a war between truth and lies.
That's right.
And considering some of the things that people actually believe today, one has to conclude they have demonic help in order to believe the crazy things that people are saying. For example, everybody knows there are two genders, male and female. God created them male and female. To believe that there are 38 genders, as some have insisted, is a bold-faced lie. You have to be listening to the chief liar himself, Satan, to believe such a ludicrous idea. How stupid can you get? A child goes to school and said, "Today I'm a cat." And the teacher has to treat her like a cat. Have we lost our minds? Now, if you think hell's not involved in destruction and it is not a war between evil and good, then you must be out in space somewhere. Don't go out there. You might can't come back in. There are some issues, you know. That's not even why. Hallelujah. A professor of psychology and behavioral economics at Duke University ran a series of experiments with some 30,000 people and found that very few people lie a lot. Most everyone lies a little. They don't lie a lot because most people are afraid they'll be caught if they keep on lying. It's not because they're wonderful people and don't lie. Chances are you've told a fib or two. Well, I ought to see every head in here bobbing, because some of you obviously can't even bring it out of your mouth to say, "Well, yeah, it's me." We need to be saying, "It's me, oh Lord."
Amen.
Not my brother, not my sister. It's me, oh Lord.
Amen.
Oh Lord. And that through our lives, many of us have told many a lie.
Yes.
Oh, not big old things. Oh, some of you told big old things. Now, if I'm talking to you, just keep looking at me and don't look down or roll over or anything, and I won't know it's you. But I don't mind saying it's me. Hallelujah. I keep reminding people, for those of you who watch me, because you think I'm so much younger than I am, hallelujah, but that I had a life prior to, whole life, that I have hope to God. And thank God for the blood, it's gone. Thank you, Jesus. And you better thank God. We all have an opportunity to be dishonest. And we all have ways of justifying why we now still tell a little lie. You see, there was a shifting in our nation that began after the end of World War II. A certain complacency developed in the 1950s that paved the way for the confusion of the 1960s. What a time that was. You know, everybody was free. Hallelujah. A time when confusion began to normalize. Yes. The Beatles claimed to be more popular than Jesus Christ. And personal feelings replaced moral values. Yes. That's still here today, strong. While all this happened in the world, the church struggled to try to keep up with what was going on. And some of them invited it into the church. As the culture unraveled, a crisis of faith began to happen in the church. Before too long, men of God like Billy Graham, Oral Roberts, Charles Stanley, W.A. Criswell, many of them, were sounding the alarm that you find in Psalm 14. Only fools say in their hearts, there is no God. They are corrupt and their actions are evil. What the fools that say this? Their actions are evil. Not one of them does good. The sad truth about Pontius Pilate is that he knew that Jesus was innocent. Right. He said it. It's in the Bible. But because of political pressure, we better be listening. But because of political pressure and a woke mob outside demanding, crucify him, crucify him, Pilate caved. And in Matthew, the Bible says that Pilate took a basin of water, washed his hands, saying, I'm innocent of the blood of this man. You crucify him. That was a lie. Pilate was not innocent. For he knew the truth.
That's right.
Anybody listening?
Yes.
But lacked the courage and moral fortitude to apply it. Everyday church, we choose truth or you and I choose lies. Every day. And while we complain about politicians who lie, what about us? Have you looked in the mirror lately? We find ourselves in a situation, if you don't fact check, you have no earthly idea, because we got some powerful liars, and you have to choose which is the closest to the word that I can stand with. And there are several things that just are blatant in your face if you serve God.
Amen.
I dare say that there isn't a person in this sanctuary that and light it sometimes or another. We all know it's wrong, so why do we do it? The greater question is, why do Christians lie? Psychologists will tell you that some folks lie for the purpose of controlling a situation. Now, don't you go to sleep, you need to listen. It's going to impact your life in the days ahead. Folks lie for the purpose of controlling a situation. That others lie to hide a wrongdoing. Others lie to make themselves look good or to avoid disappointing someone else. But those are all rationalizations. As disciples of the Lord, we are persuaded to take to heart the words of Paul to the Colossians, Colossians 3. Don't lie to each other, for you stripped off your old sinful nature and all of its wicked deeds. That's not who you are anymore. And just because today's culture has made lying acceptable, if you've chosen to live by the Word of God, lying is not acceptable. The crowd that believes in my truth or your truth is deceived. We have a whole generation of people that do not believe in absolutes, unchangeable things, solid things. This cannot be moved. It cannot be played down. One, Jesus is coming for the church. Telling the truth is not just helpful for limiting compulsive behavior. It's essential for a wholesome life. And lying isn't just a matter of the tongue. Acting as if we're something we're not is a form of deceit. It's called pretense. So why is it important? Why is it so important to tell the truth? Because truth is at the very heart, the very essence of who God is. Yes. Consistently telling the truth can be painful on occasion because we all have this inner drive for self-protection. So when we feel insecure, we often default to a lie. By doing so, inevitably, it will cause problems sooner or later. Abraham lied about his wife, saying she was his sister. He did it twice. The result was that he was humiliated before Abimelech when he was found out. After his major mess with Bathsheba, David tried to hide behind a lie. Well, honey, he had a prophet named Nathan who came and talked to him face to face. The sons of Jacob had a hard time with their younger brother, Joseph. They lied to their father, suggesting that Joseph had been killed by a wild animal. Mm-hmm. Took years, but in the end, they had to bow to the brother that they had despised. Ananias and Sapphira, as we get closer to our living days, held back part of the money, but professed they'd given all of it. They lied. It cost them their lives. You see, church, sin will always cost you something. But abiding in truth will bring prosperity, will bring great spirituality, will bring, you know, materiality. God will do for us as we stay in truth. Truth isn't a thing. Truth is a person. Jesus himself is truth. He was in the beginning with God, and all things were made through and by him. He was full of grace and truth. He's not partial truth, or he's not some part of truth. He is truth. He said in John 14, 6. Jesus told him, I'm the way, I'm the life, the truth and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. Amen. I don't care what you think. You're not going to see the Father if you don't know me. You're not going to heaven. And yes, there is a hereafter. Today, the world makes it very easy to slip into behaviors that feel good at the time, but are ultimately very destructive, which is why folks tend to create a false persona or a mask to cover up their behaviors. That inevitably leads to guilt, shame, and we cannot get out of the cycle of destructive speech until we make a firm decision to stop lying, stop pretending, and start being who you really are. Until we're willing to tell the truth about our triumphs, the truth about our failures, the truth about our joys, the truth about our worries, we will not be truly accountable, and therefore you are not prepared to change, and you're not going to grow in the things of God. That's for sure. Amen. Whatever the reason for pretending, it's important to recognize when you're doing it and choose instead to be the person God made you to be, you will be free. I want you to listen carefully to me now. You see somebody about to fall off the bench because they're sleeping, poke them. You want to hear this, because this will go rattle your cage. And I'm on my way to the end. For it's the truth that will set you free. Paul said it was for freedom that Christ came. It was for us that he shed his blood so that our lives could be clean and pure and we could come boldly to the throne of grace. John 8. Jesus said to the people who believed in him, "You are truly my disciples if you remain faithful to my teachings." If you remain faithful to my teachings. And you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Many times we've heard people say, listen up, we just need to love people. Or we just need to love everybody. There's truth in that. We do. But however, it is not loving people that will set them free. That is not, nowhere in the Bible do you find you love somebody to be free. Hell is filled with people that God loved. Let that sink in. And no one can love more than God. And if hell is filled with people that God Almighty loved, just like he loved you, we can't say love by itself sets people free. God sent Jesus to die for you and I, that we might have an eternity with him. Yet that group of people who refuse the love of God, they're in hell today. How can that be? Choice. Amen. Because it's not love that sets you free. Oh, I know some of your blood pressure has gone up. Get your Bible, honey. It's not love that sets you free. Now, I'm not knocking love. We all need it. Not knocking love. God is love. No. It's not love that sets you free. It's the truth. Jesus is truth. It's knowing the truth of God's love for you that sets you free to be truthful. Did you get that? Because it's not love that sets you free. It's the truth. It's knowing the truth of God's love for you that sets you free to be truthful. When I know and can understand and believe that God really loves me and I accept him as truth, the more I know I'm forgiven, the more I know that he has wiped out my sins, the more apt I am to find freedom. And to believe his love for me. Let me say something, for instance. Missionaries, for instance, we could say in other countries, or we can say in inner cities or wherever, or right now, just we could call any of us a missionary. They show love, but lack of truth correction. If truth correction is not put along with the love, love by itself will not keep them from killing you. Right. Truth of who they are and what God has done for them is what changes their life. Do you understand what I'm saying to you? So how do you know if you're a real truth teller? How do you know if you truly have integrity or if you're a pretender. If you're pretending to be somebody you're not, let me give you just a few things. You're afraid to let your guard down because you're holding on to an old hurt that you won't let go of. You routinely look for outward signs of approval from other people. You knowingly go against, if you are a pretender, you go against your own inner conviction. In other words, if you're standing with someone, you won't have the gumption to say, you know, I really don't believe the way you do, but it's okay if you believe that way. But no, I'm not really in agreement. And then if you have real strong convictions, you can say, let me tell you why. Because you fact-checked all the way back to the Bible. Another thing, if you're a pretender, the word should is part of your conversation. In other words, you say, I know I should do that, but. Now, all of us do that sometimes, but if yet that's your total lifestyle. Now, to contrast, what evidence can be seen in your life if you're a truthful person? Truthful people quote others accurately. You represent them correctly. There have been many a person who have misquoted me and gone out and said, I don't believe this, and in the church, or that I said something I didn't say, or stood for something that no one had ever asked me about. But they made assumptions, or in order to help themselves, they'll say something that is totally inaccurate about me. Oh, I'm just using me because I'm an easy target. Truthful people are genuine, they're authentic. Truthful people will make eye contact with you and not just go all over the place. They'll stay with you. They're not afraid to look you in the eye. Truthful people offer prompt correction when mistaken. When they've been proved wrong, they will quickly say, I'm wrong. Truthful people learn from past experiences. Oh, God, may I learn from past experiences. Amen. Yeah, yeah. And truthful people are teachable.
Yes.
And truthful people ground themselves in the Word of God.
Yes.
Now, I am coming to an end now. We must never let anything stand between us and the truth of God's Word. If there is ever a time that we get uncomfortable with the truth, it's only because we've gotten comfortable with the lies. Jesus was painstakingly explicit in speaking to the Pharisees in John 8. For you're the children of your father, the devil, and you love to do the evil things he does. He was a murderer from the beginning. He's always hated the truth because there's no truth in him. When he lies, he is consistent with his character, for he is a liar and the father of lies. So when I tell the truth, you just naturally don't believe me. How in the world did Jesus look at religious people and say what he said in Matthew 12? You brood of snakes, how could evil men like you speak what is good and right? For whatever is in your heart determines what you say. If you ever want to know the status of your heart, listen to what you talk.
That's right.
Listen to your mouth. Listen to what you say. His word tells us that there's a lie out there. In fact, a whole body of lies whose purpose is to destroy nations and peoples by promoting every kind of falsehood. There's evil out there. So I'm asking you to make truth one of the highest priorities of your life. Before we go for communion, I'll remind you that this election will tell who really loves truth. It will tell others if you would admit where you really are, who you are. And guess what? It will tell you who you are. Truth matters. Truth matters. If you're here today and you don't know the Lord Jesus, please don't leave without knowing Him. Are you watching? The end of the age is coming. We're watching it. We're part of it. The closing down of an age. It's amazing what God is allowing us to see. And He wants us to have keen discernment and not sloppy agape. And He wants us to be faithful to His word. And He will help us. He'll do it again for us and help us. Do what again? Set us straight. Forgive us. Walk with us. Encourage us and help us, because that's who He is. So if you're here, everyone's welcome to come to the table. If you're born again, washed in the blood of the Lamb, if you don't know the Lord and don't belong to Him, I would say to you, don't come. Because the Bible says people come to this table and some are sick. Some die because they come pretending, or they don't take it serious about what He has prepared. Because you and I are people of feeling and touching and tasting. So He prepared something for us so that we could remember what He did and what He said, because He's coming so soon. And so as we come today, we need to remember who He is. And as we partake of the bread, we need to remember He really did what He said. Amen. By His stripes, He really did make a way for us to walk in victory in our lives. He made a way for us to wipe out pain and disease out of our bodies. He made a provision for us. And every time we come, depending on what we really believe about it, we should at least progress to some degree. Can I say it that way? I don't want anybody to be on any kind of guilt. We all deal with aches and pains and hurts and the things that the devil tries to put on all of us. But God gives this as a reminder of a covering, that He's still inside of you and He loves you and He's still bigger than anything Satan tries. Don't you ever feel guilty because you're having trouble. Don't you ever feel guilty. Just remember who He is and thank Him for the provision He made. And believe when you come today, hey, I'm going to kick it up a notch today. I've been having trouble and I've been down here, but hallelujah, maybe I won't come all the way out, but I'm flat on my way out. That's a good old Georgia term. I'm on my way out. Because God paved the road for me to walk in victory. And He gave this to me as a reminder. He's still in the healing business. He's still greater than anything or anybody. And when you come, whether you come for the little cups, or where you come for the cups that had the little piece of thing on it, or whether you come to drink from the common cup, there's literally nothing in your life, I don't care what it is, that the blood cannot wipe out, do away with, to such a degree that you really don't have to face it again. It's all based on what you believe. But everything I'm saying is the God's truth. Amen. Truth is at this table. Truth is sitting here. Truth is a reminder. These things are reminders of truth. God cannot lie. He cannot say something and it not come to pass. Amen. That's who He is. So you are invited to come. And if you have things in your life, get it straight before you come. Well, how can I get it straight? Right where you are. Repent. And if that person you need to ask forgiveness of, they're not here, Lord, make a way for me after this day And I'll get to them. I'll do. Again, don't get caught up in sloppy agape. Just be faithful to the Word and stand on the truth of who He is. He's a wonderful God. Thank you, Jesus. You may come as the ushers lead you. Come and dine and walk out in great freedom.
Thank you.
is coming. I promise you that much. Truth. Look at your neighbor and say, I'm going to tell the truth. Say, I'm going to be a truth bearer. A truth bearer. One that we can tell the truth. Michelle, come on and close us out, honey. Hope you'll be with us tomorrow evening. Dangerous days in front of us. Dangerous days. Evil people want to see destruction, not only of the nation, but certainly of the church. And we need to remember that. But greater is he that's in us Amen. Than he that's in the world. And we need to stand firm on who God is. Church, be tight with each other. Love each other. Be tight. Be tight. Be tight. We must in the days ahead. I love you. You're wonderful people. Let me ask you this. Don't get in everybody's face, okay? As you go out. I mean, you know, you can hug people, but you don't have to pull them and just, carry on and on. Give them breathing space. And we're going to do this thing. Amen. As we join in the goodness of God. Amen. Amen. I love you, Michelle.
Amen. We are going to do this thing. Amen. Amen. Father, we thank you for the word today. Father, we thank you that you provide, Father, truth. We don't have to wonder what it is. We don't have to think about what it is. We don't have to ask anybody what it is. Your word says what truth is. So, Father, as we go forth from this place, let us walk in truth. Father, let us take truth into every situation, every conversation. Father, let truth be our guide. I thank you, Lord, for your truth. Father, as we leave this place, Father, I thank you for going before us, behind us, on each side of us. Thank you for keeping us safe. Thank you for giving us the ability to discern. Father, help us to know what to do, when to do, what to say, and how to say. But Father, always letting truth take priority. Father, I speak a blessing upon those who are watching today, those who are in the house. Father, those who wish they could be in the house. Father, I would ask, Lord God, that you minister to each one according to their needs. We thank you for health and wholeness and victory that belongs to us because we belong to you. Until we see each other again, Lord, I ask that you go with us and bring us back. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you for being here today. We look forward to seeing you tomorrow night. God bless.